Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7. In your notes, you will check out the fact that Daniel's vision of the four beasts and the Ancient of Days is what we're going to be talking about. And we have that notation there that in the past, Daniel's interpreted other people's dreams. But tonight, we're looking at chapter 7, and it's actually Daniel's own dream that he has experienced. It's the angel of the Lord who appears to Daniel, and he begins this out. And on the date of this dream, about 553 B.C., do you remember when Nebuchadnezzar died? It was 539, so it kind of gives you a little bit of an idea of when this is happening. It begins by saying, in the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel saw a dream and visions in his mind as he lay on his bed. Now, we've got a couple of things happen here. If we want to just point out a couple of things. When you think of Belshazzar, you've got to go back to Daniel chapter 5. He's the one that during the big feast, the writing of the wall appeared. And he is the one who was feasting and drinking and carrying on big time. When God said that's going to be it for the kingdom of Babylon. He was co-regent with his father, Nabonidus, and that's because Nabonidus was an absentee king and had commissioned this area to him. And this is that Belshazzar. By the time you get to chapter 6, you're talking about Darius, because the conquering has taken place, and Babylon has fallen, and then Darius takes things up there in chapter 6, and you have the whole scenario laid out with the lions and the lion's den. We're going to talk about lions here tonight as well, but it's a little bit different, okay? In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel saw a dream and visions in his mind as he lay on his bed. He wrote the dream down. He related the following summary. Daniel said, I was looking in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea, and four great beasts were coming up from the sea, different from one another. The first was like a lion, had the wings of an eagle. I kept looking until its wings were plucked, and it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man. A human mind also was given. And behold, another beast, the second one, resembling a bear, was raised up on one side, and three ribs were in its mouth between its teeth, and they said to it, arise and devour much meat. After this, I kept looking. Behold, another one, like a leopard, had on its back four wings of a bird, and the beast also had four heads, and dominion was given to it. And after this, I kept looking in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrifying and extremely strong. It had large iron teeth. It devoured and crushed and trampled down the remainder with its feet, and it was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And while I was contemplating the horns, behold, another horn, a little one, came up among them, and three of the first horns were pulled out by the roots before it. And behold, this horn possessed eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth uttering great boasts. You may remember back in Daniel chapter 2 that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And Daniel was able to receive from the Lord what the interpretation of that dream was. Do you remember what that looked like? Do you remember the scenario? On top, the head was gold, and the arms and the chest were
silver.
The stomach,
bronze.
And you get on down to the legs, and you have some iron, right? And you got down to the feet, and what did you have? Clay and iron, that's right. And we said that the iron was representative of what empire?
Rome.
The Roman Empire, correct. And so you have Nebuchadnezzar, the head, the gold, and Babylon, and then you had Medes and Persians, and then you had
Greece,
and then Rome. And so there are similarities between these two dreams. You may recall that at the bottom, where the feet were, there were how many toes?
Ten
toes, right. And he makes a point of saying that. He makes a point of saying there are 10 toes. And so that's kind of a clue that will help us with this next vision that Daniel himself sees, because Daniel's going to see this, and there are certain things that stand out about it. So as we look at it, just from a perspective of an overview here, we're looking at it, we're saying chapter 7 and chapter 2 differ from each other in a couple of different ways. So when you look at this, Daniel sees the vision and the vision himself, and the emphasis turns really to Israel and their future, especially from chapter 8 onward. You may recall that parts of this book were written in Aramaic, and parts were written in Hebrew. The Aramaic part will stop after chapter 7, and when we get into chapter 8 next week, well, in 2 weeks we'll get into chapter 8, it will be all about the Hebrew. And so this is really focusing on the people of Israel at this point. What we're going to understand is that there were a lot of things here that were pertaining to these Gentile empires. Remember, Daniel is being written during the time of the first empire, the Babylonian Empire. And then what ends up happening is you have a fulfillment that takes place with regard to the Medes and the Persians, and then also Greece and Rome. In the 2nd century, in the 3rd century, there were people who really struggled with the reality of Daniel because the prophetic aspects are so clear and they line up so well that they said Daniel could not have possibly been written prior to those empires, because it's just, it was unnerving to them to think that God had given this type of prophecy and it's fulfilled like it is. They kept looking for different things, like, well, we don't see a mention of Cyrus the Great anywhere. And it doesn't happen until the 19th century, where all of a sudden that cuneiform tablet is found and you have it, pretty clear. So as time has gone on, then from the 3rd century, really up until late 1800s, you don't have the criticism. And then once you get into the 1900s and higher criticism and all of that, all of a sudden you've got questions as to whether or not Daniel was written after those empires had already gone off the scene. I can tell you this, the exciting part is the fact that God gave it to Daniel, and it was absolutely right on the money. And it is so exciting to see just how detailed all of this prophecy is. When we get into these sections here, for instance, in 3 weeks, we'll be on Daniel chapter 9. We'll be dealing with Daniel 70 weeks as we go through that prophecy. We'll be talking about some of these things that really pertain to Israel. Remember that it's all about Israel all the time. I said that last year when we did our prophecy time together. It's all about Israel. It's always been about Israel. It's not about the United States. Even though we live here and we want to find out what's going on. I mean, how many of us care, you know, what's going to happen, right? We're also, oh yeah, we'd love to know, Pastor Kevin, tell us. But the reality is, it really is all about Israel. And as you look at how Israel's future is going to unfold, there were certain aspects here that were very important to encourage the people of Israel. And as they go through some really rough times, they have some things that they can really be excited about and things that they can look forward to. So here you have this vision, chapter 7 and chapter 2. You have the emphasis there on Israel's future. And it's interesting because when you get to chapter 7, you find that chapter 7 is similar in 5 ways. It has the same framework of symbols. There's these 4 aspects, where you have these 4 empires. You have the progressiveness of the inferiority of the first 4. For instance, you go from gold to silver to bronze to iron, and those metals become more inferior. You go from the lion, who's the king of the jungle, right? And then you go on down to the bear and the leopard, and then you end up with a wild beast that John is able not even to identify. In the second kingdom, there is the same duality, where you have those 2 arms. Remember that vision? He's got the 2 arms. Remember that great picture that I drew of the abominable snowman? He's got those 2 arms. Here you have 2 sides as well. When it talks about the wings of the leopard actually coming out, they actually come out of its sides. The same tenfold division of the 4th kingdom with those horns and toes are interesting, how they match up as well. So you have the same interpretation of the 4 as they equal kingdoms. Those are important things to remember. Chapter 7 does differ from chapter 2 in a couple ways. One, the kingdom's picture as ravenous wild beasts in chapter 2. Well, and when I think of this, in chapter 2, you have really God's viewpoint there. The emphasis is on the one world leader, the Antichrist, in Daniel chapter 7. He's an important part of this fourth empire. So tonight when we start pulling this apart, we're going to find out we're going to be introduced to the little horn. And the little horn here is actually a reference to the Antichrist. So now things begin to start getting ratcheted up, because it not only talks about the Antichrist, but it'll talk about his judgment, his fall, and some of the things that he's involved in as well. Well, let's get right down to the beast's appearance. First of all, you start off, you have the four winds of heaven. These are heavenly forces that God sends to stir up the world. And these winds, possibly four spirit beings, angels, that are churning things up. And this is in Daniel's vision where he looks at this and he sees the stirring up of the great sea. So this vision, he's looking out there, he's seeing this huge roar of waves and tempests and all of these things that are going on. It must have been a horrifying sight, because when you stop and you look at an ocean that's just boiling over like that, that itself is pretty fearful. But then up out of that comes this first beast, or this first creature, that is a lion. And he identifies it there. He says a lion, and it had wings of an eagle. In your notes there, the beast description, the lion is a reference to Babylon. In Jeremiah 4, it says a lion has gone out of his thicket, and it's talking there about the judgment on the people of Israel at the hands of the Babylonians. Later on, in verse 13 there of Jeremiah 4, it talks about horses that are swifter than eagles. Now, it's interesting, because it tells us here that the first was like a lion, had the wings of an eagle, and he says, I kept looking until its wings were plucked. And it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man. A human mind also was given to it. The best that we would understand is that this is a reference to Nebuchadnezzar, who, when it says his wings were plucked, he's talking about the defenselessness of this man when he was struck with the disease that he had, where he lost his mind, and he's out there like an ox, and he's going around eating grass, and totally out of his mind, not able to understand anything at all. And then the Bible says that here he was made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and a human mind was given to it. He's talking there, I believe, about Nebuchadnezzar all of a sudden at the end of that 7 years. Remember, Daniel had said, this is going to be a 7-year judgment. They put him out to pasture, literally. And in 7 years, his mind came back and he stood back up on 2 feet. Now, let me just say this to you. If you go online and you start digging around on Daniel chapter 7, you start looking for, you know, different interpretations. I'm giving to you the interpretation that I believe is the best. This has been, for decades and decades, the orthodox interpretation. However, there are crazy interpretations out there. I like this one fella he wrote. He said, most so-called prophecy teachers will tell you that Daniel's beast represent the same nations depicted in the great statue of Nebuchadnezzar. So-called prophecy teachers. They say the lion is ancient Babylon, the bear is, you know, right on down the line. And he goes on and he says, well, that's absolutely not true. And he says that basically all four of Daniel's four beasts are said to be in power and in existence when Jesus returns. Well, if that was true and that's what the Bible said, I would tend to agree with this person. However, he doesn't give any biblical evidence for this. In fact, we're going to go journeying on over into the book of Revelation tonight before we're done. And we're going to look at Revelation chapter 13 and discover for ourselves what the Bible says there in verse 1. These four beasts, he says, cannot be the ancient kingdom, as most Bible commentators and teachers assert. And he says, Daniel saw the other three beasts had their dominion taken away, and yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. That's chapter 7 and verse 12 of Daniel. I believe what that is a reference to is the fact that when these capitals were struck down, so oftentimes the nations themselves lingered on in one form or another. These were huge world empires, and it took time for them to just kind of drift away. There are influences as well that continue on. For instance, the Greek Empire, it wasn't like all of a sudden Greece is replaced by Rome and they started speaking Italian. It's the Greek language was a universal language for the most part, and it continued on. So I don't think he has it totally right here, but he goes on and he says, we must identify a modern nation symbolized by a lion, a modern nation symbolized by a lion, a modern nation symbolized by a bear, and a modern nation symbolized by a leopard, and a modern global government that fits the description of the dreadful beast. This other person says, well, here it is. I've got it all figured out. He says that in Daniel, the lion is England, because they had a symbol of the lion. Incidentally, Babylon, upon doing the archaeology there, they found out that lions with wings were pictured in much of their architecture, all over the place, in fact. But England, they have a coat of arms, and they say that this is Daniel's lion is really England. And those plucked wings, that's the United States. Now, I'm telling you this, and some of you are laughing. If we weren't on YouTube, I'd say something at this juncture. However, I don't want this to come back and bite me. But, you know, I remember as a kid hearing this taught in Bible study. I was maybe 12 or 13 years old, and the pastor was pointing out that here's the United States. And that carried so far. Even to this very day, I can have certain discussions with certain people who remember the pastor who said back in 1969, okay, or 1971 or whatever year it was, that, oh, there's the United States in prophecy. So you have to be careful. Now, when you think of a bear, what do you think of?
Russia.
So obviously, I mean, this bear has to be Russia. It has to be Russia. And it's got three ribs in its mouth. And if you think through when the war took place and so forth, that's, you know, those three countries went right down. But then you get the leopard. And what country could possibly be the leopard? Germany, of course, because they have leopard tanks. And the wings there, the fowl, is, you know, a reference to Germany's coordination along with France, because France's national symbol is a rooster. And the guy who just wrote that said after thousands of hours of study, he came to that conclusion. Now, the problem is, it starts to get more and more far-fetched. And in this one, they say, well, Daniel's the conglomerate piece. But you will find, if you go Googling around and you go wading into a lot of websites, you'll find where there's modern nations and the United States is always usually pegged somewhere in there and put in that list. Sometimes the United States is used as part of a conglomerate in that fourth nation, the revived Roman Empire, and it's put into that as well. And when you read it, let me just say this, when you read it, sometimes, and this was a bad case, but sometimes they do a good job of trying to make their case to a point, and then when it starts to get to the outliers, it really gets nuts. I mean, it gets crazy. And you look at it and you go, am I really reading this? I mean, seriously, this is where you went with this? And it makes absolutely no sense. First of all, I am absolutely convinced that the Lord is coming soon. Amen. As the Apostle Paul was, I must add. I believe, you know, and it's like, yeah, well, the Apostle Paul, I mean, you know, he had insight and so forth, and when he said, you know, Lord's coming soon, you know, who's to argue with the Apostle Paul? And who are you to argue with me, right? I mean, so, but we don't know, and that's the whole thing. So you have to be very careful about putting things into a modern day context. I believe that when the rapture takes place, and you're in the midst, and I said you're, I'm talking about the world, not you all, but the world will look at that and say, wow, we are in this seven-year tribulation. And there will be some who will understand that, and then they'll be able to put into context, modern to their day and time, who these players are and readily understand it. I'm glad I don't have to figure that out, because I'll be in heaven and I'll be doing some fun stuff with you all, and this will be great. But you see, you have to be very, very careful, because you can really spin off into some strange directions if you're not careful. So what we want to do is we want to really take a close look at what's going on here and try as best we're able to identify really who these players are and what's going on. God has been making a point all through Daniel up until this point here. He has made the same point in my mind over and over again, and that is God is in control. God is sovereign. God is all-powerful. We've seen the all-powerfulness of God when three men were thrown into the fiery furnace, and we saw the amazing power of God. We also saw a foreshadowing of the Redeemer, because when the king looked in there, he saw a fourth person, and it was none other than Christ walking in that furnace. Isn't that amazing? We see Daniel being thrust into the lion's den, lowered down into that place with hungry lions, only to find that they had lockjaw, and God was more powerful than the lions were. And God delivered him as a great testimony. We see with these images that have taken place that God is in control. You remember what happens with the 10 toes that are mixed with that clay and iron. The rock comes and crushes those toes. And over in Zechariah, we had that illustration of the four smiths, those four craftsmen, as they came and they banged on those empires and shattered those empires. So it's God who's in control. He builds up these empires for a purpose, and then it's over for them. And he's making that point. So when you look at Babylon, you realize here's a nation that was very, very powerful, but God allowed it to move on. When you look at the bear, I believe the best interpretation of the bear is Medo-Persia. These things reflect what we've already looked at. The leopard is Greece, and the terrible beast is a reference to Rome. Here's some of the proofs for this. Another beast, the bear, heavy, enormous. The armies of Medo-Persia were enormous armies. They weren't the fastest moving, but they were very numerous and very plentiful and powerful. They were raised up, as we see this bear, one side is higher than the other. Because it's Medo-Persia, you never had an equality there, because they weren't exactly the same. One is far more powerful than the other. Possibly, and I don't know for absolute sure, but most people would guess that Lydia, a rich country that had a lot of gold that was conquered in 546, along with Babylon in 539 and Egypt in 525, were the references there to the three ribs, which were very significant conquests by Medo-Persia. I think it fits really well with the leopard being Greece, there in verse 6. The leopard had four wings of a bird, speaking there of an animal that was known for its swiftness. This is speed and action. It's a fast-moving animal. They took Tyre in only 6 months, which was a really huge achievement. Tyre was not an easy city to take. Others had tried and failed. And for them to take it in that period of time by siege was just really amazing. They captured the entire known world by 323 BC. This beast had four heads. And I found that to be interesting as well. This bear that followed by the leopard, and he goes on and he's telling us that it had on its back four wings like a bird. Beast had four heads and dominion was given to it. Well, it's no question about its dominion there with Greece. But when Alexander the Great died, his empire was divided up between four generals. I believe that that's the four heads that we see. So you have Cassander, who is there in Macedonia. You have Lysimachus, who is there in Asia Minor. Syrian Babylon is Seleucus. And Egypt is Ptolemy. So you have these basic generals that are going to take over these different geographical areas of the Grecian Empire after Alexander dies. So that's some of the support for these different empires. The terrible beast is a reference to Rome, verses 7 through 12. And you pick this up. I believe that it didn't even look like an animal that Daniel was able to say, well, this is kind of what it looked like. Remember, he's not saying these are definitely a lion. He says it looks like a lion. It might have been something a little bit different. But as he keeps looking, wouldn't you keep looking too if you were Daniel? Yeah, I'm going to pay attention. He's looking, he sees this fourth beast, and it's described in a terrible way. It's dreadful, it's terrifying, it's extremely strong. I think we get a little bit of a clue there with the fact that its teeth are iron, going back to Daniel chapter 2, and that statue and the iron representing Rome there. But it is terrible and dreadful, and it is devouring, crushing, and trampling down the remainder with its feet. And it was different from all the beasts that were before it. That's verse 7. Devouring, breaking, and stamping, or trampling. Those are participles in the original, meaning ongoing action. This is something that's going on. They were really, really nasty. And so, there they are. And here is this creature. And the Bible describes this creature, though, in a different way. It says it's different. But then you'll notice at the end of verse 7, it has 10 horns. And while I was contemplating the horns, behold, another horn, a little one, came up among them, literally came up between them. And so there is Daniel, and he's trying to make this clear what he is seeing. And he sees this terrible beast. I mean, this beast is just brutal looking, right? Yeah, maybe. That's terrible. Let's give him ears. Maybe that'll help.
That's abominable snow when I've seen that.
You find here that he has.
Yeah.
He has 10 horns. All right, those are the 10 horns. And on top of that 10 horns, out from between them grows a little horn. A little horn. One of the things that we know, if we look at Scripture, when we come into a reference of horns, horns are generally associated with kingdoms, okay, in Scripture. And this is an interesting one because you have 10 horns and you have an 11th horn. The 11th horn comes up and does away with three of the horns. And the little horn doesn't stay little very long. In fact, the little horn grows into a very large horn. And this is what Daniel's seeing. So he's trying to figure out, well, what does all this mean? The three of these 10 horns were pulled out by the roots before it. Now that is speaking there of a battle of sorts. This is a violent uprooting. It wasn't like the three just faded out. They are rooted out, I mean, just pulled right up by the roots and gone. And so you have 10 of these horns representing some type of kingdom. And when this little horn comes up, it displaces or pulls out of by the roots three of those kingdoms. And it grows into a very, very sizable kingdom itself. And as you're looking at this, he says here, behold, this horn possessed eyes like the eyes of a man and a mouth uttering great boasts. Well, there's a personification that's taking place here with regard to this little horn. This little horn has come up out of this beast. And I would say that the best understanding for us is that this beast is a replica here of the Roman Empire. And when I say a replica, there are certain traits with regard to the Roman Empire that are being duplicated with this. And we're talking about an empire that, when we get to Daniel chapter or Revelation chapter 13, I'll point this out, but there are certain characteristics of this beast. It's very terrible in the sense that it's able to go out there and really smash and crash. there's a huge aspect of world domination, like the Roman Empire dominated. The Roman Empire was really, really strong at being able to not only go into these different areas, but to be able to secure them. Think Palestine, think Jesus' day, with the Roman soldiers and all these people that were representing Roman government. Remember, they were very well organized. But out of this Roman Empire, see this guy, he's crying. Because it's really not about him. It's really about this guy right here. Because he is the one who comes up out of this empire. And so when you think of this fourth beast, you can kind of dismiss this aspect here and focus right here on the little horn who is the Antichrist. You want to focus on that Antichrist. That's important. And this Antichrist really becomes the embodiment of this fourth empire. And that's important to remember. I have so many things to say tonight. How are we going to get through all of this material? When Daniel sees this, he realizes there's some things that are happening that are pretty amazing. Eyes like the eyes of a man, and mouth uttering great boasts. I think there's some characteristics of this little horn. One is that he has eyes of a man. You say, well, what does that mean? Most likely, that's speaking of insight and a real keen mental ability that this person has. He is a very unusual person from that standpoint. He's also one who likes to brag. He likes to boast. He wants to tell you how great he is and how great he's going to be for the world and how, you know, and he's going to say, I'm going to go and solve world problems. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to solve these world problems. And to his credit, he's able, because if we get there tonight, we're going to see Satan is the one who's behind him, and Satan is the one who's energizing him. Okay? And so, again, when you look at this, this is how this is starting to come into focus. Is there anyone who is going to stand up against this terrible beast? Notice this next passage is fantastic. I kept looking. I would too. He says, until thrones were set up. Daniel says, the Ancient of Days took his seat. His vesture was like white snow, the hair on his head like pure wool. His throne was ablaze with flames. Its wheels were a burning fire. A river of fire was flowing and coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands were attending to him. And myriads upon myriads were standing before him. The court sat, and the books were opened. I believe we're going to be part of that. I believe we're going to be part of the myriads and myriads standing before him. This is a description of God the Father. And it's a neat description. One of the things that strikes me is this is not Daniel's description of God. This is God's description of God. And this is God choosing for himself his own name. Don't you love that, Ancient of Days? This is God saying, I am the Ancient of Days. And what a description. Here is this fire, and the fire comes from his wheels. And think of that lava that flows into the river, the oceans there in Hawaii. Sometimes you'll see that on TV, and maybe you've seen it in person, I don't know. But, you know, you look at that, and it's so breathtaking when you look at that lava, that molten lava. Can you imagine from in front of God comes this flow of fire? Thousands are attending him because he is truly worthy of praise. There these thousands are, and myriads are standing before him. Wow. What a fantastic sight. This is an amazing sight. And God is the God of justice. He says, I kept looking because of the sound of the boastful words which the horn was speaking. I kept looking until the beast was slain, and its body was destroyed and given to burning fire. As for the rest of the beast, their dominion was taken away, but an extension of life was granted to them for an appointed period of time. As for the rest of the beasts, you see, these other three beasts that have been mentioned here were very important parts of Israel's history. And their empires did trickle out over time. But they are not nearly as significant for our point of study than this fourth empire is, where we have the mention of the Antichrist. This is an amazing time. The beast is going to be judged, and judged soundly. Notice the Son of Man receives here an everlasting kingdom, verse 13. I kept looking in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like a Son of Man was coming. And he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom, that all the peoples, nations, and men of every language might serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which will not pass away. His kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. When Jesus Christ comes back, the millennial kingdom will flow right on from the beginning of it, right into eternity. There will not be... there's that final battle at the end of the millennial kingdom, but Christ is always on the throne. And he's always victorious. And so here we look at this and we say, well, here is God the Father, and God the Father is given. And I believe the Son of Man there is a reference to Jesus Christ. And he's talking here about his second coming. And Jesus is going to come. And to Jesus is given dominion, glory, and a kingdom. And we know that that kingdom is the 1,000-year reign of Christ, which takes place after that second coming. And so here we are with our timeline. And we recognize that really the next event to happen is the rapture. We're living now in the church age. The rapture takes place, and there's 7 years of tribulation. And this is where God is pouring out his judgment. But it's not until the very end that you have Christ return. And the Antichrist is standing here in defiance when Christ returns. After the return of Christ, you have the 1,000-year, or the millennial kingdom that he sets up. And the promises that are made, for instance, in your Bible, in Matthew and so forth, when you go to Matthew 24, 25, those are kingdom passages dealing with a future fulfillment that will take place during that millennial kingdom and relates to that millennial kingdom. Because remember, it's all about the Jewish people. Okay, it's all about the Jewish people. Another name for this period of time, especially the last half of the tribulation, is the time of Jacob's trouble. You see, it's very much oriented to the Jewish people. And they come back and they will repent of their sins. So it's pretty exciting. The interesting thing in all of Scripture to me is the fact that Jesus Christ allows for the church to be grafted in to the body of Christ. That's a phenomenon that is beyond our understanding. Who are most of the people that get saved during the time of Jesus? Jews or Gentiles?
Jews.
Right after Jesus ascends into heaven and we have Pentecost takes place in Acts chapter 2, what people group is more and more coming to Christ? Jews. Jews. And then all of a sudden things began to change. And we had some outliers there with some different cities that were more Gentile, and we had Gentiles coming to Christ. And so you have this transition that takes place in the book of Acts, where you have in Acts chapter 2, the Jews receiving the Holy Spirit, and then later you have the Samaritans that are half-Jew, and then you have the Gentiles who receive the Holy Spirit, and you have that transition taking place. By the time the Apostle Paul hits the ground running, he is called to basically minister to the Gentile people, and they were really receptive to the gospel as a whole. And so now we, I believe, outnumber the Jews in the body of Christ. But it didn't start out that way. It started out with the Jews coming to Christ, and later we had the privilege of being added to the body of Christ. And so, exciting that we're able to be able to see that happen. So, going back here to the synopsis, in verses 15 through 18, there's the general interpretation as Christ's dominion here. As for me, Daniel says, my spirit was distressed within me. The visions in my mind kept alarming me. I approached one of those who were standing by and began asking him the exact meaning of all this. Isn't that great? I love that he's asking that question. It's like, if I could stand here and say, please ask that question. So he told me and made known to me the interpretation. These great beasts, which are four in number, are four kings who will arise from the earth. But the saints of the highest one will receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever for all ages to come. Then I desired to know the exact meaning of the fourth beast. You see where Daniel's attention goes? It goes to that fourth beast. Because it's different from all the others, it's exceedingly dreadful, teeth of iron, claws of bronze, devoured, crushed, and trampled. Same three words he used in the Aramaic there that he used earlier. Devouring, crushing, and trampling down the remainder with its feet. And the meaning of the ten horns that were on its head. And another horn which came up, before which three of them fell. Namely that horn which had eyes and a mouth, uttering great boasts, which was larger in appearance than its associates. I kept looking, and that horn was waging war with the saints and overpowering them until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was passed in favor of the saints of the highest one, and the time arrived when the saints took possession of the kingdom. That gives you a little bit of a synopsis of what's happening here. This little horn is the Antichrist. Remember, when the Antichrist is revealed, it will be immediately following the church, and the church is being taken up into heaven. Shortly after that, however, we find that there are some people who are placing their faith in Christ. And there's a sealing of the 144,000 who will go out to evangelize the world. The Bible speaks in Revelation about the tribulation saints. These are believers who have been killed because of their faith in Christ. Remember, Satan is able to do some amazing things. He's able to cause, because his mark is the number 666, he causes people not to be able to buy or sell without having that either on their forehead or on their wrist. And he is saying, you know what, here it is. Either you perish or you renounce Christ. And he puts the pressure on people. And because of that, there's a tremendous number of people who are killed. And that's what it's talking about there. He is going to go out and he is going to persecute the saints, the people that are turning to Christ by faith during the tribulation. So there will be people here that will be saved. Now this coming Sunday, we're in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and the Bible talks about, and God will send a strong delusion so that they will not believe. We're going to talk about that Sunday. You know, what does he mean by that? You know, what's he talking about? And so we'll look at that. And while some people will not have the opportunity to be saved during the tribulation time, others will have the opportunity to be saved. And they will come to Christ. And many of them will die because of their faith in Christ. So the fourth beast is that fourth kingdom, Rome. And it really holds some understanding for us when we get to chapter 9 and we start to study the 70 weeks and that whole prophecy that Daniel speaks about. The Antichrist is very, very aggressive. You'll notice his activity there. He's going to speak words against the Most High. He is a blasphemer of God. He's a blasphemer of God. Fourth beast, be a fourth kingdom. It's different. There's ten horns, and out of this kingdom, ten horns will rise. Another will rise after them. He'll be different from the previous ones and will subdue three kings. He will speak out against the Most High and wear down the saints of the highest one. The description there in verse 25 is very apt. And it speaks about wearing out a garment or wearing out a wineskin where just the rubbing against it wears a hole. And the idea is that here are these believers who are trying to follow the Lord. And literally, the little horn, the Antichrist, is just wearing them out. It's wearing them out. And it's a terrible time. It's a terrible time to be alive. It's a terrible time, though, to be alive without Christ, even if you're facing that persecution. And so he is very dominant during this time. Verse 25, he'll speak out against the Most High and wear down the saints of the highest one. He'll intend to make alterations in times and in law, and they will be given into his hand for a time, times and a half, a time. So, here he is. He's very, very busy. It's very likely that when it talks about him, he's going to go against every law of God. And he's going to even try to make alteration in times and in law. These may be a reference to moral and natural laws, and he is trying to change those laws. We have a lot of laws changing now, don't we? During the French Revolution, they tried to make it a 10-day work week, and it didn't work out so well. Yeah, I see your faces. You're all fired up. It didn't work out that well. Maybe that's what he's thinking about. But you'll want to take note of the fact that this is something he's thinking about. He doesn't actually implement. He's not able to implement it. But he's trying to disturb all the laws of God. He is trying to do everything he can to really pull down and tear down the very fabric that God has ordained. And he is going to be in this power. He'll intend to make these things happen, and they will be given into his hand for a time, times, and a half time. Let's just do a little math here. Here's a time. What does times look like? More than one time. And a half a time. Which is actually 3.5 years. You'll want to remember that when the Antichrist is revealed, he's revealed right here at the beginning of the tribulation time. That's where he's revealed. But it takes time for him to gain power. And he really doesn't get to that point until right here at the midpoint of the tribulation, where he's really into that dominant world figure. So there are certain things that have to happen. He will quickly rise on the scene. Remember, 7 years isn't really all that long. 3.5 years is really not all that long. In fact, when he comes on the scene, I think people will be pretty excited about it. They're going to be looking at it from the standpoint of here's this person who is a Messiah. And the Christians, the people that are nominally Christians, Christians in name only, will throw support behind him as well. And you hear a lot of people try to guess who the Antichrist is or what background the Antichrist has. I just was reading something where the Antichrist has to be a Muslim. I'm thinking, really? I don't think so. But people are conjecturing that and have been for a very, very long period of time. What I want to show you now is basically how this ties in over in the book of Revelation. So let's go back over to Revelation chapter 12. Revelation 12:1 starts off by saying, "A great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars, and she was with child. She cried out, being in labor and in pain to give birth." That is a reference there. If you take notes, you want to write a note down, that's a reference there to Israel. And the crown of 12 stars is a reference there to the 12 tribes. And the child is Jesus Christ. "Another sign appeared in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns." Where have we heard about these 10 horns? "His tail swept away a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she gave birth, he might devour her child." That's a reference there to Herod, as energized by Satan to try to come and kill the baby Jesus. She gives birth and so forth. She flees to the wilderness, and she has a place prepared by God. So they all of a sudden you transition from that which is historical to that which is yet future. I know that can become confusing. She's there nourished for 1,260 days, which is how long?
3.5 years.
Your math is quicker than mine. Verse 7 says, "There was a war in heaven, Michael and his angels waging war with the dragon." Now, if the dragon was a man, he wouldn't be up in the heavens, right? And he's doing battle with Michael. Now, here's who the dragon is, verse 9. "Great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He's thrown down to the earth." So we know that the dragon that we read about here in chapter 12 is a reference to Satan. Chapter 13, verse 1. "The dragon, that Satan is standing on the sand of the seashore. This is John's vision here in Daniel, or in Revelation 13. And what he sees is he sees a beast coming up from the sea, having 10 horns and 7 heads. Where have we heard about these 10 horns? Exactly. So we flip it back over to Daniel chapter 7, and we see the connection that's there. Only this time, what we're finding is there's 7 heads, and it's expanded out to 10 crowns or diadems that are also on its head. And on these heads, these 7 heads, were blasphemous names. And the beast which I saw was like a leopard, his feet were like those of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. Where did we just hear about a leopard, lion, and a bear? It comes back to us, doesn't it? Now here's the thing. For instance, the one individual article that I was reading where the man said those 3 kingdoms have to exist simultaneously during this period of tribulation and cannot be a reference to those ancient kingdoms, I think is misreading that passage. Because what that passage says is this beast that comes out of the sea was like a leopard, like a bear, and like a lion in certain characteristics. And if you look at all 3 of those kingdoms, there were certain aspects of those kingdoms or characteristics of those kingdoms. I believe that they're all embodied in this one terrible beast. And so you've got the worst of the worst all mixed together here. And this person who's coming out, this creature, is certainly terrifying. And he would go on and say, I saw one of his heads as if it had been slain, and his fatal wound was healed. Now just a note about that. Let me just point this out. I saw one of his heads slain. Now, in some of the Christian videos in the past, the thought was always that this Antichrist probably gets shot in the head, somebody tried to assassinate him. And he all of a sudden rise back up from the dead and come back to life. And that was a huge sign to people. But if you look really careful, it's talking there not about the Antichrist heads. I saw one of his heads. How many heads does he have according to this? 7. Right. And what are these 7 heads? Do we have any idea what the 7 heads are? Well, of course we do. Over there in Revelation chapter 17 and verse 9, it says the 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sits, and they are 7 kings. So evidently, one of these kings is basically destroyed. And the king's kingdom must be destroyed, and somehow it healed up. Now, I've read different things about what this possibly could be. And I don't really know exactly what it is. It's very difficult to put that in a box. I've read things like it was when the wall was torn down in between West Germany and East Germany. So, okay. It could be a lot of things, right? But the key point here is that you look at what you can identify and what you can understand. Because in the future, you might be able to understand this better. There's a lot of things we understand better today than we did 30 years ago. Yeah. And so I believe that some of these things have to come into focus yet. But notice here too, the whole earth was amazed, followed after this beast that comes out of the sea. And they worshiped the dragon because he gave his authority to the beast. So if you back up just a little bit, after it mentions the word lion there, the dragon gave him, this creature, this beast, his power and his throne and great authority. So Satan is the direct supplier of this power and authority that this Antichrist has. And it's interesting, but verse 4 says they worship the dragon because he gave his authority to the beast. And they worship the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to wage war with him? And so there you have this beast that comes up out of the sea. Sometimes it's thought that, well, he comes up out of the sea. That's got to be a reference to him being Gentile. He comes up out of the sea, and the beast from the earth, it says, I saw another, down in verse 11, I saw another beast. That's the false prophet coming up out of the earth. Some people would say, well, that's the false prophet's a Jew. And I can't say for certain whether or not that's true. Normally, when the word sea is used, it is speaking of humanity, and it speaks there of a humanity that is broadened. And oftentimes, when it's a reference to the earth, it's a reference to Israel, but not always. And we could actually go back to Daniel and prove that that is true. So here is this one, and he is very powerful, and he comes up out of the sea. The next time that we see this beast is in chapter 17. So flip over to chapter 17 with me, if you would. I know, right now your head's like spinning, right? You're like, what in the world? Revelation chapter 17. One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and spoke with me, John says. He says, come here, I'll show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters. Again, we would look at waters as being humanity, having a very broad influence on humanity, with whom the kings of the earth committed acts of immorality, and those who dwell on the earth were made drunk with the wine of her immorality. And he carried me away in the spirit into a wilderness, and I saw, now notice what John sees, I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast, full of blasphemous names, having seven heads, and you'll never guess how many horns. 10 horns. You got it. So who is that one? Who is this beast there? Then if we would understand it properly, who is this beast? It's that Antichrist, right? That Antichrist who has these
10 horns,
but he wiped out how many of the horns?
Three.
On his way up through, he was the 11th horn, but now there are how many? If he destroys three,
eight.
Keep that in your mind. Go home tonight and read the rest of chapter 17, and then get thinking about that as you do the math on this. But here is this one. This woman is sitting on this beast. Now that's very curious, isn't it? Very curious. That you have a beast. I would draw a picture of a beast, but it would look like the abominable snowman. But the point is, with stick figures, how many of you have ridden a horse? How many have never ridden a horse? Okay. All right. How many have ridden? Look at that tail, huh? Look at that tail. All right. So, this is one of those knight type horses, you know, with the thing on its side, right? If you're going to draw something, you want to make sure you draw it to the best of your ability. So, it's like fingers. If you're trying to draw fingers, you just draw a club hand, you just make it round, and it's good enough. Well, here's the idea. This is this beast, and I'll just do this, and I'll do, okay, there's eight. Very curious that this Antichrist would have a rider on it. Because what does that suggest? We'll make her have long hair. And she's riding this beast. And she's happy about it. Her being a rider here is showing that she has influence and control over this creature. You with me? So that's an interesting phenomenon, and it's worth paying attention to. Because somehow this, as described as being the harlot, is able to influence this great beast. And he is so powerful. He's blaspheming the names of Jesus. He's able to do these miracles. He's getting the world to bow down to him. But before the midpoint of the tribulation, something has to happen for this beast, this great Antichrist, to be able to take power. And what he has to do is he has to be able to rid himself of the rider. Okay? Now let's go back to chapter 17. The beast in verse 8 that you saw was and is not and is about to come up out of the abyss and go to destruction. And those who dwell on the earth, whose name has not been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, will wonder when they see the beast, that he was and he is not and will come. It's more than likely, the understanding there is that this is the revived Roman Empire. Here's the mind which has wisdom. And I know you're all minds that have wisdom, right? So this is just right up your alley. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits, and they are seven kings. Five have fallen, one is, the other has not yet come. And when he comes, he must remain a little while. So there's seven kings, five have fallen, one is, one hasn't come, and when he remains, he has to be there a little while. And no, I'm not going to try to explain that tonight. But I will mention this, the beast which was and is not is himself also, and how many?
Eight.
Where did we hear about the eight? Yeah. He's one of the seven, and he goes to destruction. The ten horns which you saw are ten kings who have not yet received a kingdom. But they receive authority as kings with the beast for 1 hour, or for a short period of time. So they have one purpose, and their purpose is that they give their power and authority to the beast. So here are these who are giving their authority. They are kings without a kingdom. But they have power. They have a lot of power. They have a lot of power. And they want one thing, and they want their power to be infused into his kingdom. And their alliances and their allegiance is to him and not to her. Notice what he goes on and says. He says that they will, these kings, wage war against the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them because he is the Lord of Lords. So they're going to wage war against believers. And he said to me, the waters which you saw, where the harlot sits, are people in multitudes and nations and tongues. And the ten horns which you saw, and the beast, these will hate the harlot. Ah, now it's starting to come together, isn't it? They're going to hate the harlot. Both this beast right here, he is not happy that she is riding him. But she's been useful up until this point, you see. She's been very, very useful up until this point. She has helped him rise to power. But she outlives her usefulness. Don't we all? As we understand it, who is the sidekick of the Antichrist, Revelation chapter 13? The false prophet, or that one world religious leader. You have the epitome of ecumenicalism embodied in this one person who is able to lead the charge internationally, and he will do everything he can to put that person into full power. This person here, this woman, is hated by these kings and by this Antichrist, and the Bible says they will hate her and make her desolate and naked and will eat her flesh and burn her up with fire. For God's put it in their hearts, to execute his purpose by having a common purpose and by giving their kingdom to the beast until the words of God will be fulfilled. So the woman who you saw is the great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. Ooh, interesting. So guess what happens? She's destroyed. She's gone. And these guys are gone too. Because they existed to give their power to this beast, this one world leader. And that's why the Bible says they only had that power for 1 hour. It was a short period of time. After that, their usefulness was done as well. They just weren't destroyed. They were incorporated into this fourth empire. See, that's what's happening here. Now, I believe as you look at this, you see a lot of different things, because you can now stop, once you understand to this point, this level, now you can start trying to put into perspective, who is this woman who rides this beast? And who are these 10 kings who don't have a kingdom? And it really gets you thinking, doesn't it? It does. It gets you thinking. Let me see if I can wake my computer up and see if I can energize this thing. It'll take a little bit, probably, to warm it up. The last line in your notes is, this is the end of the Aramaic. So if you want to put that in there, you can.
It's coming.
Just takes a little bit of time. So what we have done is we have seen the creatures, these four animals, come out of Daniel's vision. And we see God's perspective here. We see these animals come out of his mind and his vision. He describes them. We go over to the Revelation. We see how Satan is behind all of it, Revelation chapter 12. By the time we move over to Revelation 13, we see this beast that comes up out of the water. And lo and behold, this beast that's coming out of the water is very, very much in step with the beast that we just got through reading about in Daniel chapter 7. And then lo and behold, we go over to Revelation chapter 17, and we find that this woman who is riding the beast, that's the same beast as was before mentioned, and goes all the way back to Daniel. Hello.
Tell your computer that the projector is on.
I should see more than that.
And unplug and plug it back in.
You'll never believe this, but that is a statue that sits outside of the Winston Churchill building. And you see it's a woman. Her name's Europa. She was a Phoenician goddess. Zeus came and captured her, hauled her off, raped her, married her, maybe. I don't know. But a woman riding a beast. Interesting, isn't it? This is a coin, European Union coin, and you have a picture of the woman riding the beast. And that's in front of the European Union Parliament building, a woman riding a beast. Interesting. Just saying.
With or without it.
So understanding what the definition of that would look like, and I think we pretty much know and understand who the identity of this beast is all about. We definitely have an affinity, as you can see, in certain places that are listening towards globalization and a one world currency and a one world government. You definitely see this theme playing out more and more in the modern world in which we live. So that's something interesting to stop and consider. So sometime down the road here, we can discuss who those 10 kings without kingdoms might be, and who the woman riding the terrible beast might be as well. But it's pretty fascinating stuff, isn't it? Wow. Isn't it amazing how Daniel got that right all the way back then? Isn't that amazing? You know, I mean, it really is, it's incredible. It's incredible. So there she is, Europa. Mercy. All right, now that your heads are spinning, it's time to just kind of start to coast mentally and relax. Let's have a word of prayer. You've been great. Lord, we thank you for the prophecy in your word. We thank you, Father, for the identity of these creatures, Lord. We thank you so much for the Ancient of Days. God, you are awesome. And we look forward to that day when thousands will attend to you, myriads will stand before you. And Lord, we truly are blessed to be able to say that we're joint heirs with the Son, Jesus Christ, because of the ministry of Christ on the cross, canceling out our sin, paying for that debt of sin, and beating the sting of death as he rose from the dead. What a joy it is, Lord, to be a Christian. Whatever generation we find ourselves living in, it is a joy to be a Christian. And we just thank you so much for the fact that you reassure us, Lord, every single day that you're in control of all these things. So help us, Lord, to be faithful. Help us, Lord, to know that you are worth following in every way possible, Lord. We love you, and we pray that we just really show that in the way in which we live. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.